My name is Jaime Jay. I am the CEO and founder of Bottleneck Virtual Assistants. I was trying to go live with the legendary Christopher Lockhead and the amazing Morgan Wright last week, and I had some technical issues. And so thank you all for hopping back on, and really appreciate you being here. This is going to be an incredible conversation. We're going to be talking pretty much about what leaders are doing right now. We're going to be talking about discussing some of these issues with the coronavirus and how businesses are operating from not only a tactical point of view, but a marketing point of view. The reason that I bring Morgan on and Christopher on is I kind of like a no BS, no filter type thing, but I want to inspire you in such a way that us as leaders or, you know, dealing with these changes, we can still get through all of this. And without this being woo-woo or hoo-ha or anything like that, it is real. And I do understand that. So I'm hoping that we're going to have a lot of fun here and talk about this. So before I introduce you to Christopher and Morgan, I would like to introduce you to them via a quick little bio here. And Morgan is a good friend of mine, and he is an internationally recognized expert on cybersecurity strategy, cyber terrorism, and advanced technology. And his landmark testimony before Congress on healthcare.gov changed how the government collected personally identifiable information. He has made hundreds of appearances on national news, radio, print, and web, and has spoken to audiences around the world. And for those of you that don't know my good friend, the legendary Christopher Lockhead, after getting out of thrown out of school with few other options, Christopher started his first company at the age of 18. He served as chief marketing officer of a software juggernaut, Mercury Interactive, which was acquired by Hewlett Packard back in 2006 for $4.5 billion. He also co-founded the marketing consulting firm Lockhead, was the founding CMO of internet consulting firm Scient, and served as head of marketing at the CRM software firm Vantive. And now he is the host of two amazing award-winning podcasts, Follow Your Different and Lockhead on Marketing. So without any further ado, let me introduce you. Morgan, welcome.
Sir. Sir.
How are you?
No, no, day's not over yet. That's a forward-looking statement subject to rules and regulations by the SEC and now the CDC. But as of 15-10 hours, dude, what else can you do but say it is what it is, it's good, except, you know, expect nothing, just accept everything. You know, we deal with what's in front of us.
Isn't that the truth? That's the truth. And Christopher, welcome.
Jaime, thanks for having us. Morgan, good to see you again. And by the way, to promote my dear friend here, Mr. Wright, he is clearly Mr. Wright. We're dropping an episode tomorrow of Follow Your Different, starring none other than Morgan Wright.
Hey, but I'll tell you, Christopher is a top podcaster. In fact, the dude crushed it with my buddies, Steve Murphy and Javier Pena. You got to listen to those two episodes. I send it to everybody. Charted, what did you get up to, Christopher? Number 29 on all podcasts, on all 900,000 podcasts on iTunes. You came in at number 29, I think.
I think we actually hit 20 at one point because of Pena and Murph. Yeah, it's an incredible, those guys are incredible. They're true American heroes. The two real DEA Narcos agents who took down Pablo Escobar. If you're a fan of the show Narcos, these are the real deal. These are the real guys. And Morgan was kind enough to introduce me. The guys came out to Santa Cruz. We spent some wonderful time together. We had dinner together, hung out. And then we captured on podcast. Look, I'll just say what I think. I think it's as legendary as people talking podcasts can get. Yep. Because these guys tell you the real story of how two guys partnered with the Colombian government over the period of about 6 years to dismantle his empire and bring the world's first narco terrorist to justice. And to say these guys are true American heroes is to put it mildly.
Yeah. Exactly. And I just wanted to say, Morgan, Seth Weckley just gave you a shout out, said, hey, great seeing you here, amigo.
What's going on, bro?
So I will kind of be monitoring too if people have questions or anything like that. And I thought maybe before I go into, I've got about 30 questions already from people that had inquired the first time around we were going to do this. But I wonder before we can go into that, if maybe you guys can give us kind of a quick overview of your thought as far as where we're at right now and what you're doing and what you're sharing with other people as leaders about, you know, keeping things going as much as we can or cannot, or if you can just kind of maybe jump in and tell me what you're thinking about right now. And I'll go ahead and come back in with the questions as soon as you give us an overview.
Chris, you mean?
Well, you got started, Mr. Wright.
You, me, you? Okay. Actually, I just got through writing a blog for a buddy of mine. He's got a public safety company and application. It's called First Two. But so I wrote it because we wanted to start people thinking differently about this time. Look, in addition to what Jaime told you, I spent 18 years in state and local law enforcement. I worked in the intelligence community as a senior advisor in the U.S. State Department Anti-Terrorism Assistance Program. The reason I say all of that is when I was a detective, the Oklahoma City bombing happened. You know, Timothy McVeigh, Terry Nichols. We had never had a bombing like that before in the U.S. And in fact, they built the bomb 5 miles from my boyhood home. They built it at Geary County State Lake. I grew up in Chapman. My mom processed both Nichols and McVeigh out of the Army. My former training officer arrested Nichols in Harrington, Kansas, Dickinson County out there. The reason I say all of this is I had the chance to follow up on leads with the FBI on this. And we had never been faced with it before. It was something new. Move out to Virginia. I'm not out here very long. 2001, what do we have? We have 9/11, something we had never faced before. I walked across the bridge into Roslyn and I saw the Pentagon burning. And if you thought that wasn't bad enough, just 7 days later, we get hit with the anthrax attacks. Had never had that before. Then what happened? The DC sniper. We had never had that before. And then in my roles with, like I said, the State Department, we're going over to Pakistan, places like Turkey. We were doing things in the global war on terror we had never done before. We started having to think differently about how to solve these big problems. And so that's kind of when Jaime, we talked, and this blog I wrote, it was kind of like, guys, I will not use the term new normal anymore. Why? Because it implies that you have to accept your condition, that you must accept it. You don't have a choice. Well, you do have a choice. You know, you can change this. It doesn't just, you don't have to be, you don't have to be confined to this reality to say, well, that's the way it's always going to be. We'll never go back to restaurants and stuff. No, we will. You know why? Because we're going to figure this out. This will end. It will end. I can't tell you a date. Be foolish to tell you a date. Nobody can predict a date, but it will end and we will get back to business. We will figure this out. What people lack, and you got to put it in perspective, my dad, and you can see the flag behind me here. My dad was a World War II and a Vietnam vet. We had men in World War II and women leave and serve their country for 4 years. They stormed the beaches at Normandy. Folks, we're not asking people to storm the beaches at Normandy. Just wash your hands, stay away from people, and stay home for 2 weeks. And you know, I'm not trying to make it simplistic, but that's the reason I think, Jaime, we will get through this. The means to solve this are in front of us. We just have to think differently and act differently.
I love that. I absolutely love it. I think you're right. We have to think different. It's weird, right? It's good. I guess we do have some precedent in looking back at different things that happened in history, but with where we are in technology and where we're at today, it's really hard. This is like uncharted territory for us as we know it. I don't know. What do you think, Christopher?
Look, we'll just state the obvious. It's fucking weird and people are freaked out and no one's ever been here before. And yes, there've been plagues and flus and things, but nothing like this in modern history. And so, none of us know what the fuck's going on. And so that's sort of point A. And I think it's okay to be freaked out. I have my moments where I'm freaked out too. And I think that's fine. I also think, you know, I love the quote from Hunter S. Thompson, when the going gets weird, the weird turn professional. And so I think it's time for real leaders to stand up, you know, to quote Eminem, will the real Slim Shady please stand up? I think it's time to stand up. I think it's okay to be freaked out and stand up at the same time. That's what I'm trying to do. And so the question I started asking myself a couple of weeks ago was, if I was a legendary leader, what would I do now? And, you know, I could tell you some of the answers that have been working for me and my family and friends, but that was a powerful question to me. And then I think this is a time where we need a tremendous amount of empathy and compassion, tremendous amount of empathy. The pain and suffering this is causing at mass scale is beyond comprehension. Obviously, there's the obvious healthcare situation. People getting sick, and of course, people dying, and it's tragic, right? And there's massive economic dislocation like we've never experienced before, and so that's very, very concerning. And so I think right now empathy matters, and so there's sort of two big themes, and I've been working a lot with my buddy Eddie Yoon on this. Is okay? So what are you going to do in this situation? And I think an obvious answer is if all of us can make a difference where in areas where we make a difference, that would be powerful. And what I mean by that is, okay, so what can you do? Well, you can practice the good things that we're being taught to practice, social distancing, blah, 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 all that good stuff, and be very, you know, on it about that shit. Take this shit very seriously. So I think that hopefully speaks for itself. But beyond that, you start to say, okay, well, what can I contribute here? This notion of radical generosity. How can you be radically generous? How can you make a difference? And there may be some financial things you can do, and that's a good thing to do right now. Carrie and I could tell you the whole story if you like, but the net of it is we got a line on 105 cases of gloves. And so we're buying them right now, and we're giving them to our local hospitals in Santa Cruz. Wow. There are things like that we can do, right? And then you say, okay, well, in your area of expertise, are there things that you can contribute? And so for me, as a marketer, as a three-time CMO, I woke up about a week and a half or so ago and went, hey, shithead, start contributing some marketing stuff. And so we've already got one episode of our marketing podcast out, really dealing with this. Eddie and I are writing an article right now for a Harvard Business Review on these two ideas, one being radically generous and the other one being thoughtfully aggressive. Now's the time to be thoughtfully aggressive, both in terms of how we deal with the crisis itself, the virus itself, as well as how we deal with our businesses. And, you know, I can sort of dig into any of that at any level of detail you want. But at the high level, that's, I think, where we're at right now, where our thinking's at.
And let me throw into something you said real too quick, Christopher. Everybody, if they'll just do their little part, I know that nobody follows a lot of what I do. It doesn't matter. But I have my little Facebook thing. I'll put it up there, and it's called Support Your Local Biz. Every day what I've been doing is picking a local business saying, here's a business I support. You ought to support it too. But then I put my money where my mouth is. We order online. We go buy. We pick up stuff, or go, patronize them, and overtip. You know, I realize, and kind of what you're saying, I can't solve every problem. But look, if I will do my little part here, if other people do their little part, so you know what I want to do? I want to make sure when this recovery comes, and this recovery will come, that these small businesses are there. The big ones, I'm not worried about. You know, the Amazons, the Microsofts, the big giant. I'm worried about the small moms and pops who are the economic engine for this country. Without them, we lose, you know, what is it, 60 to 70% of all the jobs in the U.S. So I'm doing, you know, what you're doing, Christopher, about gloves, that's awesome. And what I'm trying to do is keep people employed here, realizing that if I add my piece up with somebody else's, I want to keep these, I patronize them, I buy. We'll go grocery shopping, but we'll still go eat somewhere just so we can buy something from them. I'll buy extra. We'll save some of it for later, but I'll overtip, and just to make sure that these small moms and pops stay in business. And that's why I like your thinking about, you know, just being aggressive on the stuff and saying, look, you cannot sit on your ass on your couch and think the problems are going to solve itself. It's just like Teddy Roosevelt said, and I just want to double check it before I said this, do what you can with what you have, where you are. I'm doing my little piece right here in Loudoun County.
I love it. And you know, there's a question Matt Smith is asking, that kind of, you guys may have just answered this, but he says, how do you stay positive with changes happening by the hour?
Look, kind of goes back to when you talk to World War II vets, you talk to special operators or even cops, firefighters, people who have faced a lot of danger, fear. And it's like Christopher says, of course you're scared, but courage is doing the right thing in spite of your fear. And I think what you have to do in spite of all the fear is realize there will be a tomorrow. We will get through this. You're here to help your fellow man. And I'll tell you, you want a recipe for staying positive? Turn off the fucking news. Get away from that stuff, because all it is 24/7. Doesn't matter what side of the political spectrum you're on. Either he's doing it right or he's doing it wrong, or either Congress is right or they're wrong. It is nothing but a virtual vomiting on you of why you should be scared, because guess why? People respond to fear of loss more than they do fear of gain. Think about marketing, right? What's the offer that gets people pulled in? It's they're about to lose something. Why do they keep people hooked on TV? If they had positive stories about those stories, if you look at the whole compendium of stories, those stories are one out of every 50. What are the other 49? What's going on? Who's dying? How bad it is? How fast it's spreading? Look, I can't do anything about that except my part. What's happening in Italy, I have a lot of empathy for. What's happening in South Korea, I have a lot of empathy for. But I can't control that. The more you listen to the news, the more you buy into that, you think that you have a responsibility to solve a problem somewhere else in the world. No, the problem you have to solve is to do your part, do what you can with what you have, where you are right here. And I think the easiest way to stay positive is turn off the damn news, read some good stuff, watch a couple good movies, and realize as long as you do your part, we will get through this. This situation will resolve and we will come out of this.
Christopher, any feedback on how to stay positive with changes happening by the hour?
Yeah, I think so. So I of course agree with everything Morgan says. Of course.
100%.
Of course.
The other thing I'd say is, and who was the individual who asked the question?
Matt Smith.
Matt. Hey, Matt. Here's the other thing. It's okay if you don't feel like staying positive, and you feel like however you feel, that's okay. So look, I think we are all freaked out. If you're not freaked out, you're not fucking paying attention. Right? So it's an extraordinary time. And we are all going to have moments where something will happen, or we'll hear something, or, you know, this happened for somebody that I love a couple of days ago, who'd been sort of pretty fine. And then all of a sudden it just hit her, and she had 12 hours where she was real shaky, and, you know, she's sort of back now. So I think the first thing, we have to be kind to ourselves and be empathetic to ourselves, that we are going to be freaked out. It's a freaky situation because of the health scare. It's going to affect people we love if it hasn't already. And it's literally affecting every single person economically. And so there's lots to be freaked out by. That's the first thing. The second thing, however, is while acknowledging that and being able to sit with that, if that's what there is for you to do, is fine. How do I want to say this? I'll just say what works for me. I'm the kind of person who I could stay in that state all the time. And I have some bipolar in me, and I could let the down get really big. While it's important to feel whatever you're feeling, it's also important that leaders stand up, that we meet this moment. It's easy to be great when it's great. Who are you when the shit hits the fan? And this is the shit hitting the fan, right? And so legends are made in moments of truth. And this is a moment of truth for the human race that we are experiencing simultaneously as a race. And so all of us need to figure out how we're going to stand up. And that's why I like so much what Morgan said. And so if we deal with our own emotions, allow ourselves to feel how we feel, but don't let it have us by the throat for too long, because we all need to stand up. And if we find our ways to be radically generous, and now's the time for radical generosity in whatever way, maybe it's financial, maybe it's other ways. Generosity comes in many, many forms. It might come in a smile. It might come, whatever it is, big ways, little ways, and every way in between. all matters right now. Radical generosity. We have to take care of each other. There are people who are already, having problems feeding themselves and their families. So like we're in that situation now, and that is likely to get worse. And so we have to be empathetic and we have to be radically generous with each other.
Hey, let me add one more thing. I'm sorry, Jamie. One more thing to that real quick. Hey, the other thing too is, especially if you've never worked from home and this is your first experience, you're being isolated and stuff. We're on Zoom on Facebook. Get on Zoom, check in with buddies. I'm in a part of a Peloton group with military veterans. We decided, what the hell, we're going to do a 100 mile ride on Saturday. It was called the FU COVID-19. So I did you should have been on there. You should get on the bike, Jamie.
I should.
Dude, but we did 100 miles, but I think part of this is get exercise, stay healthy. This is the chance. You know what? I hate to quote politicians during political, because I don't want to make this political. And this is not a saying either way of who I support. It's definitely not. It's more, I love the concept. Rahm Emanuel, when Obama was inaugurated, they were interviewing him. He says, you never want a serious crisis to go to waste, because very rarely do you get the chance to make the types of changes you need. One way to stay positive is to look at this is read number one, Jocko Willink's book, Extreme Ownership. If you want to see what to change, and read another book by David Goggins called Can't Hurt Me. You want to see people who did awesome extreme stuff. You want to stay positive. Watch what these people did to crush everything that was in front of them. Stay positive. But it was not easy. To Christopher said, it wasn't you wake up in the morning, it's like Mr. Rogers. Oh, I'm happy today. No. It is a slog each day, but you got to make that choice to say, here's what I'm going to do today to make myself better, to do things, to own this. And if you watch Jocko on Twitter, 4:30 every morning, this dude is up 4:30 in the morning working out. Doesn't matter if he wants to or not. He gets up and he does it. So find the things that put you in that frame of mind to keep you positive. And, sunlight, this is going to sound so simple, but it's true. Sunlight, get exercise, eat better. This is the chance to change your habits so you can stay positive and you'll come out of this better than you went into this, Matt. By the way, do we know Matt? Do we send him a parting gift? Can we send him a book? Because that was such a great question.
Anybody here write a book? Anybody here have any free Scooby snacks for Matt?
Well, I actually have a portable bidet that we can send out to people, and that way they can, save on the TP and all that kind of stuff. So we can definitely get that.
Oh, can we talk about bidets? Can we have that conversation?
Uh-oh.
Oh, it just depends, dude. With your mind, I'm afraid where this is going to lead.
No, I'm just telling you. My wife, for our wedding anniversary a couple years ago, got me Samantha. And Samantha is a gourmet bidet made in Japan by the experts. And I mean, how many people do you know that name their toilet? And I'm just telling you, some guys have a man cave. I have a man can.
That is legendary, dude. You've even
done it today. And it's all designed around Samantha because she's an extraordinary person.
Next question, please.
Yeah. That's awesome. Well, Sean Peterson did leave a comment. He said, love this conversation. It's going to force us small business owners to be really creative with new sources of revenue and ways of planning for a future I would never have thought about. Not just food services. We are a small outpatient PT clinic having to reduce hours or lay staff off. You can bet we will have telehealth rolling as quickly as they can, which is a big deal. And then former St. Louis Blues hockey player, the first person to score a hat trick for the Anaheim Mighty Ducks, Terry Yake, asks, ooh, when will hockey be back?
Hockey? What's hockey? Is that a sport?
How's it going, Terry? Is Terry Canadian? Are you Canadian, Terry?
He is Canadian.
Yeah, hey. I figured he might be. How's it going, eh? I was born in Montreal. I don't fucking know. I think there's a chance we'll be lucky if big groups of people can start coming together in the fall. But I don't know. I mean, they're experts saying we're in for 18 months. There are people talking about if we start backing off on social distancing, this thing is going to boomerang on us. I don't think it's possible to know. I have some friends who were planning on competing in the Olympics. As you probably saw this morning, the Olympics got canceled. And my heart goes out to the athletes. And the interesting thing about Olympic athletes, of course, depending on what the sport is, they have to wait 4 years for their shot, right? And pushing it back a year could mean a lot of things for a lot of athletes' careers. And, my heart goes out to them. They've been training for 4 years for this, and now it's not going to happen, right? And it's such a weird, as a sports fan myself, it's so weird. No basketball playoffs, no Stanley Cup, Terry. I'm a huge fight fan. Well, almost every Saturday night there's a UFC fight. There's no fucking fights. It's so weird for us not to be sharing.
It is crazy. It is crazy.
Hey, let me go back. Who made the comment, Jamie,
about his phone?
I'm sorry?
Terry Yake.
Hey, Terry, but Terry, let me actually throw something out to you to think about too. Here's something I've noticed. If you're a small business and you've got a social media presence, you need to be on this like white on rice, like gum on a shoe. When I've posted just on these small business, the things that got me feeling good that they're actually listening is I've had a couple of these businesses reply right back and say, oh, thank you so much. Oh, thank you. Appreciate you doing this. There's a couple of them that went radio silent. I would say right now, you've got to keep that sense of community engaged out there. If you're a small business, if you're not on it, get on it. If you're doing it, do more of it. Amp that up. Figure out ways to connect with people. Set them up so that when the time comes back to where we can start going back. Who decides to call me right in the middle of a webinar? I forgot to put this on Do Not Disturb. How rude. But I'm telling you, I think that connection, even though it's social, even though it's just over social media or things like that, keeping that connection going as a small business, reaching out, letting people know you care, tell them what you're available for. Well, I'm finding more and more of these businesses say, hey, we're still open. We're doing curbside service. Just call us. We'll come out. We'll drop your stuff. I've got to get bird feed. We love feeding our birds here. Even my bird food store said, hey, all you have to do is call in and order, pay for it. Come by, swing open your door. We'll throw it in for you. No contact at all. People are getting creative on how to understand the current situation and still serve their clientele. And I know you've got a little bit different thing, but Christopher is more expert on this than me. But I'll tell you, I think people are missing. Again, you never want a serious crisis to go to waste. This is the time if you're going to go in on social media and marketing and showing people you care. Now is the time to get in there and start building a name for yourself as the business that cares. Find innovative ways to give back, but serve your constituents, serve your community, serve your customers. Find new ways to do that.
Yeah, I love that. I've got several more questions. I don't know if we have time to get to them all, but the next question I have is from Lisa Godfrey. And Christopher, if you want to take the lead on this one, she asks, how will this affect our economy long term?
So I'm not an economist, of course, and math was over for me in grade three. So disclosure. Here's what I'm hearing. Essentially, most businesses are going to lose plus or minus a quarter of their revenue. So Q2 is over. Now, of course, that's not true for all businesses, and there's some businesses that are uniquely advantaged by this and are going to grow from it. And Amazon and Walmart are hiring 100,000 people, and so it's not true for everybody. But the net of it is, I've talked to people in the food business. Well, they're down 90%. Most of the people in the tech business that I've talked to, plus or minus, they're down 50%. And so it's across the board from almost the entire business to half the business to a handful who are going to grow as a result of this. But I think the net of it is we're probably going to lose. Most businesses have to consider that they're going to lose a quarter's worth of business. Now, that may end up being overly dramatic, and I hope that's the case. But I think if you're wise, that's a planning assumption that isn't stupid. Let me say it that way. And then I think at an individual level, I think there's a chance that we got to be ready for 6 months of no income. And what does that mean? And if you're a business owner or you're a CEO of a major company, you know, I think you have to start thinking about how you can stretch out your financial resources as long as possible. So, for example, a couple of days ago over text, I was talking with a buddy of mine who runs about a 40-person marketing agency in Australia. And he was telling me how much cash they have, how much the business is down, how many people he's got on payroll, and all the things they're thinking about. And so one of the things that we got into a debate about was how much should he cut, how quickly? And so if you can make smart reallocations or cuts, you can stretch out your runway. And so I think these are all things that we have to be thinking about, Lisa, because I think the bottom line is we're all going to be in tough economic shape. And I think the economy it could lose massive amount of at least one quarter and potentially two. We just do not know. The only good news, if there's any good news, is we're sort of all going through it together. So that's, you know, it's not, we're all in this shit show together. And then the last thing maybe I'll say about this, yesterday I shot an episode of my podcast with Chris Fussell. He's a retired Navy SEAL, and he was the chief of staff for four-star General Stanley McChrystal. And now he's the president of the McChrystal Group, and he's co-authored a bunch of books with Stan, as he likes to be called. Anyway, Chris and I had a fantastic conversation. We're going to be dropping it next week, and he's an incredible, inspiring American leader. And they're working with public and private sector folks right now on how to be forward on your skis and deal with this situation. And one of the points that he made is we have to understand that the people who are going to be hit the hardest are people who have are in low income areas or have lower incomes, as well as people who have health and medical problems, right? Mm-hmm. And we got to get in front of helping those people right the fuck now. And so I think whether it's the aid package that hopefully will be coming from Washington soon here, if the two parties could just fucking get something done. Obviously, that'll make a big difference, we hope. But I think those of us as citizens who can make a difference here, it behooves us to try to do things to make a difference and to remember that people who have the least amount of economic security have the highest amount of, from an economic point of view, I'm not talking about the health side, they have the most amount of anxiety and they have very, very real fears about how they're going to feed themselves and their families and deal with rent and the basics of life. And so I think those of us in a position to make a difference, that's a big place that we can make a difference. And hopefully as this stimulus package gets put together, it'll make a difference there. But the point Chris Fussell was making is we need to over focus on disadvantaged folks and people who have the least amount of economic cushion or security.
Yeah, be mindful of that. And by the way, Michael Hernandez says, good stuff, guys. As a small business owner, I try to use your knowledge every day. Thank you all. So just wanted to let you guys know that what you're saying is resonating with people. James Slimp said, and Morgan, if you want to take this one, he said, who killed JFA and what are they putting in the water? Just kidding. I'd like to know if they think that this will become a seasonal issue and do we expect a second spike?
Well, who killed JFK? I mean, we clearly all know that's been just watch the Seinfeld episode. It was all taken care of there and they are putting fluoride in the water. Don't worry. And other things. So. And what was the third part of the question? Because I was trying to be funny and then all of a sudden my mind went off.
What is JFK and what are they putting in the water? Just kidding. I'd like to know if what you think, he said they, meaning you and Christopher, what you think this will become, if it will become a seasonal issue and do we expect a second spike?
Yeah, look, not a healthcare expert. I listened to the expert. One thing I decided to do, and this is a very good point here. The news, every station, doesn't matter who, look, folks, just be transparent. For 15 years, I've been And actually currently serve as the chief technology analyst for Fox News and Fox Business Network. I'm non-political. I do ones and zeros, not R's and D's. You know, and I've listened to people, and I will even tell you from a news standpoint, if you want the information, go to the experts to get it. I've got about three sites bookmarked up here, the CDC site, the John Hopkins site on the disease spread. I live in Virginia, Northern Virginia, the Commonwealth. I pull information from there. This is going to be like anything else. I mean, and this is where you've got you as a consumer, as the citizen, got to get educated. COVID-19 is the disease. The SARS virus, the particular SARS that they call it, is the virus that causes the disease. So when they start talking about antivirals and we start talking about vaccines, words mean things. So all I'm doing is I'm telling you, I'm listening to the expert. I actually had a chance. I saw the progression of things. I was down at Fox News listening. I actually had a chance to have a discussion with Dr. Ben Carson when he was down in the green room. This is the last time I've been down at Fox because they've totally eliminated guests being on site. But everybody says, and this is what the experts are saying, they're saying it's going to be like a flu season. You're right. I mean, we're going to get it's going to take a while to get the vaccine out to where we become vaccinated against it. So you can't get it, you know, and there will be antivirals right now to help eliminate the disease so that you can recover from it. But it will be like anything else. But I tell you what, this will change again. You never want a serious crisis to go to waste. I think if this does a couple things for us, we will not only impact COVID, you know, and coronavirus, we will impact a lot of other diseases because it will change our hygiene habits. It will change the way we think about things. It will change the way we think about food preparation and how we, you know, I tell you, it was a great line. James Woods, he's fun. I love him on Twitter, you know, great actor too. But do you guys realize the purpose of the handshake? The purpose of the handshake only was in the times of ye olden times was to simply show you didn't have a broadsword in your hand and that I wasn't going to cut Christopher heads off when we came and met, you know, on the field of battle. That's the only reason for the handshake. So think about
showing his dagger.
My dagger a lot. Yeah, I don't want to pull out my other weapons because there you go, bringing a knife to a gunfight. So you're Canadian.
Let's talk about weapons.
But I think what we're going to do is we're going to realize is that the rhythm of life is going to change for us. And I think there will be some things that come out of this that makes us better from a hygiene standpoint. I haven't washed. I tell you, the next thing I'm going to invest in are companies that make hand lotion. I've washed my hands so many times. They're now getting red. They're getting raw. But guess what? This is a reality you must accept. So I have no, the people who say they know this is what's going to happen. No, but when you listen to, when you watch human behavior, I think this will give us habits that will make the occurrence of these things less likely because it takes something like this to really ingrain upon us. We've got to change our habits. We have to change the things we do. So I think you'll see a spike and only I equate this to crime reporting because I dealt with crime for a long time. Does it mean that there's more cases or does it mean we're diagnosing more people because the same amount of cases already existed? Or, you know, is there more crime or are we just better at identifying the crime that's already been committed and reporting it? So I think you've got to watch the numbers. You got to listen to don't listen to politicians. Again, not political. Don't listen to presidents. Don't listen to senators. Listen to Dr. Fauci. Listen to Dr. Bricks. Listen to the people who this is when you listen to them talk, this is what they do. And based on what they're saying, we're going to go through. It's going to spike up. Obviously, we want to flatten the curve. And then we will have seasons of this like we do flu, like we do other things. But again, change our habits. I think we have the chance now at this trying time to change the habits so that we make these spikes smaller and farther apart and we make the impact in the future less because I think the vaccines will come out. We'll be able to treat people with antivirals right now. And I think that this is going to be a huge paradigm shift in how we think about health and healthcare and personal hygiene.
Yeah, that's a good point. Thanks for that. It is good to, I mean, I'm with you. We actually tried watching the news the other day. We didn't make it through the entire segment. It was just too negative.
Look what I have sitting on my desk. I've got two bottles of hand sanitizer. They're now worth about 0.75 million, 0.8 million right here, you know. So, no. But
there
just
you go.
I'm saying, but even little stuff like this that I wouldn't carry on my desk, you're right. We're all changing our habits.
Yeah. And so my beloved wife, she said Mark Cuban just tweeted for going back to what Christopher said, tweeted for the battling party leaders to stop fighting and to effing do their jobs, she says. But then she followed up with an interesting question. I wonder, Christopher, if you want to take this one. It says, what do they think about the 3-month shelter in place advisement? Have you heard anything about that?
I mean, look, I don't have any access to anything that you don't have access to. So I don't have any special knowledge.
What I do know is
when I talk to my friends who are scientists and my friends who are doctors and nurses, and this is my synthesis of what they, because, you know, I call them all the time now, right? A dear friend of mine, by way of example, is a pediatrician, and she's incredible. Anyway, what often they point me to, so I'll tell you what they tell me, is look at Italy, look at Spain. So, and if you look at the growth rate in New York, it's terrifying. And so to the best of my knowledge, and again, I'm no healthcare expert, our chart looks plus or minus a lot like Italy's chart. And so what the doctors and scientists that I know tell me is, look, just look at Italy, and Italy is the ghost of Christmas future. And obviously we're running hard not to be there. But when, you know, people are still landing in Maui right now to go on vacation. Mm. Right. One of my best friends lives on Maui. And 2 days ago, there were buses, Greyhound style big fuck buses, showing up at the beach, emptying out full of people onto a crowded beach. That was 2 days ago in Maui. And so, you know, they're just people who are not with the program yet, as hard as that might be to believe. So I don't know. I don't know. What do I know? Yeah. But I do know what the professionals are saying, which is we have to brace for that kind of situation, and we have to do everything possible to avoid that situation. And that's what this, you know, flatten the curve stuff is ultimately about. You know, and the bottom line is, best I can synthesize it, there's two problems with this fucking thing. Number one, it's highly, highly contagious, right? And so that means a lot of people get it in a short period of time. And that's what's taxing the healthcare systems around the world. And that's what we don't want to have happen here. And that's why the mayor of New York is building a hospital at the Javits Center. Just, you know, wrap your head around what's going on. It's a stunner, right? And so I just think we have to take this very, very seriously. If these are what the smart people are saying, this is what the head of the World Health Organization is saying. Italy and Spain are the ghost of Christmas future. We're starting to see some positive data emerging now from China. We have some positive data trending out of Korea and Singapore. And so I also think there are places we can look to for hope and for best practices, right? But I think we got to, simply plan for the worst and do everything we can so that we can get the best possible outcome, but not be naive about what's going on.
Amen. I mean, I think that's truly kind of what we got to do. I think we kind of have to be smart about this and, you know, maybe understand that life is going to take on a new normal for the immediate future. And with that, there's going to be some changes. I don't know if y'all saw it, but there's an actor. Oh my gosh. Michael Rapaport. Do you guys know Michael Rapaport? He's been in a lot of movies and stuff like that. And all these movie stars and everything's everybody's been reaching out to them saying, hey, can you do a PSA announcement about, you know, the virus? Please stay indoors and do all that. And Michael Rapaport came on and he goes, they wanted me to, let me tell you this, fuck that. Keep your kids inside. Keep them inside. If you see my kids outside, I give you permission to kick them in the throat, pull their asses inside. That's it. Stop being Mr. Nice Guy. This has got to add F-bomb after F-bomb after F-bomb. But that's kind of like, hey, kids that went down to Florida are now coming back home and now they're spreading. Like,
Hey, Jaime, just today, those same University of Tampa students, five of them, some of them that were down there that were being featured in those videos, five of the students that were on spring break got contacted the coronavirus. And it is this, you know, and the other thing that amazes me too, speaking of idiocy, is how did we get this viral stupidity that somehow toilet paper was going to save us during an event that is respiratory only? If you were worried about toilet paper, get Ebola. Ebola is what's going to turn your insides to mush and make you crap everything out. That's when you should be buying toilet paper. How did we get to the point to where toilet paper is the currency of the realm? You know, it's the coin of the realm. And I think it goes back to exactly with these PSAs. Nobody has ever yet been challenged with the way everybody says, oh, we'll be okay because we're young, you know, or we'll be okay because of this. No, you won't be. And what will happen is because you think you're young, you will go out and you will infect orders of magnitude more people because you're not distancing. You look, folks, our grandparents and our parents, some of us, they fought World War II. They were left their country. They worked in factories for 4 years. All we're simply asking you to do is sit on the damn couch. A year ago, that would have got you in trouble from your wife or significant other. Get off the couch and go do something. Now you want to save your country. Sit your ass down on the couch, watch a couple good movies, pop a beer. By the way, one of the things they did not close in Virginia, they say it's a necessity, is the liquor store. So I would avail myself of liquor. Find a couple good movies, you know, and hang right in there.
Hold on. Did you just say you would avail yourself of liquor?
Yes.
Well, you know, we all have our different strategies, but part of my strategy for beating the coronavirus is drowning it in Jack Daniels.
I'll tell you, I've become a stout fan too with beer. So I found a case the CBS Imperial Stout over Christmas. You couldn't order it online anymore. I found a case at Wegmans. I'll tell you, Goose Island Bourbon County Stout, one bottle that's 12.9 ounces is 15.4% alcohol by volume. Geez. One bottle is a killer, man. But I'll tell you, but this is the chance to, but seriously, kind of going back to that, but this is the chance, you know, to change some things. Nobody knows the answer. Here's the thing. I don't care what anybody says. Nobody can predict the future. Nobody knows how this is going to go. Do what you can with what you have, with where you are. And kind of an old military phrase too, is you go to war with what you have. Look, if you're small business, if you're like us, figure out new ways to serve people. How are you going to generate? This will change forever how we do business, how we generate revenue, how we think about doing things, right? So I think kind of going back to a lot of the key issues and stuff though too, but kind of, you know, where you're going with that is, you know, I think the best thing to do is, I don't know, everybody's wired differently. I'm wired differently. Like Christopher said, he's a Jack Daniels guy and a knife guy, you know. But I think the thing together is like this, sharing information. Folks, don't look at me as some expert, zilch expertise. I couldn't tell you this. All I know is I've been through a set of experiences. And each time I thought, gee, how could anything get stranger than this, right? We're going to, you know what we're going to do? We're going to cancel April Fool's Day because there's no way in the world you can convince me you can come up with something on April 1st that is more wicked than the shit we've already been through. So, I think we cancel April 1st. We rewind this year. But to kind of Christopher's point, we got to be radical about things. It's the pendulum, right? You want things to change. You don't stay in the squishy middle. You push that. You get out of your comfort zone. You push things and do things that you would never do before. And I don't know how we got to this point. The problem is when you get Christopher and I on here, we both have significant amounts of ADD. We're going to be in Australia next, digging a hole somewhere, looking for shrimp on the bobby. I just don't know.
Well, I appreciate it. And before I get to Christopher, Morgan, how do people reach out to you and get in touch with you?
Don't say get in touch with me. Do not touch me. Okay.
How do
don't people, touch him.
How do people physically distance themselves from you, but socially connect with you?
I prefer that term better. I don't like the social distance. Very simple. MorganWright.us. I've got a website, or at MorganWright_US on Twitter. Or email me, Morgan@MorganWright.us. Very simple. Look, if you can't find me on the internet, you're not trying hard enough. I'm there. I'm like Christopher. You go put his name in there. Dude pops up as number 20 on the all-time podcast. Number 20. You were talking 900,000 episodes. And this dude is passing Oprah, Mark Cuban, Gary V, Michael Hyatt, you know, all of these names that are out there, the dude is skyrocketing past them. Even he's even ahead of some of the Joe Rogan episodes.
It's hard to believe. It's really something's wrong in the universe. See, clearly something's wrong in the universe. What I do love about it, all serious, is, you know, when we started, people said, oh, no one's going to listen to a long form dialogue podcast that's a hybrid of business, self-help and marketing. That's not going to work.
Yeah.
The other thing they said that it wasn't going to work is that in order to be successful in podcasting now, you have to either be a celebrity or be part of some giant media company, because it's just the days of an independent podcast catching fire are over.
Yeah.
And all I have to say to that is neener nonner.
Neener. Yeah, you're wrong.
Well, Christopher, do you have anything that you want to say before we wrap? Any parting words?
Yeah, I think on the business side, there's a very interesting thing here. If you go and take a look at the research on downturns, what you're going to discover is that, depending on whose research you believe, but somewhere between 9% and 14% of companies actually improve their position as a result of a downturn. And as measured by, they grow 10% or more the top line of the bottom line when compared to their peer group. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's essentially, you know, because in the last 3 weeks or so, I've gone back and read a bunch of the research on, you know, that some of the top management consulting firms, a lot of the HBR has incredible stuff on this. I think HBR is a resource that stands alone, in my opinion. But the aha here is somewhere between 9% and 14% of companies exit a downturn in a stronger position. Categories can get created or redesigned in a meaningful way during a downturn in a way that they can't. And so I would advise us to, if you're in business, the headset, the mindset is we're going to be one of those 9% to 14% companies. And you say, okay, well, how do we get there? And I don't say this like an answer. I say this like an idea that hopefully sparks thinking and dialogue. The first one is radical generosity, which we talked about. On the thoughtfully aggressive side, when you read the literature, this is essentially what the literature says about those, the top 9% to 14%. They break hard into the downturn. So they're thoughtfully aggressive immediately. They're taking actions immediately to make the appropriate changes in their business, to reallocate costs or cut costs if required, to reimagine offers. And you see big companies doing this. You see small companies doing this. You know, Hyundai has come out and said, if you're an existing customer, we'll give you up to 3 months relief on your payments.
Up to 6 months now.
They made it 6 months now. Yeah. And they have all sorts of Scooby snacks along those lines for if you want to go buy a car from them. So they're doing radically generous things as a major global corporation. And then, you know, to Morgan's point on the local businesses and the restaurants that we all love. Well, one of our favorite restaurants here in Santa Cruz is called Alderwood. And about a week or so ago, they sent out a note and they said, look, we're taking the week off. We're retooling the business and we're coming back with a pared down menu of some of our classics and favorites. And the whole business is going to be oriented to take out, you know, drive by, whatever. So they announced a day or two ago what the new menu is, and we got it. And to Morgan's point, you know, we're going to do that. Right. And so that's all in the domain of both thoughtfully aggressive and radical generosity. The aha is the mindset for business leaders is we want to be in that 9% to 14% that actually grows as a result of this downturn. And the question we ask ourselves is, how can we be radically generous to make a difference at this time? And how can we be thoughtfully aggressive with our business? Another example of thoughtfully aggressive: a day or two ago, the New York Times announced that they bought a software company. So let's just think, and the software company takes text and converts it into audio. Further proof that podcasts are the future, and clearly what the New York Times is doing is creating a capability to have the front page of the New York Times read to you. That's what they're setting up. Okay. Now let's think about this for a second. The New York Times sells subscriptions and advertising. Now, subscriptions might be going up because people are consuming news, but you got to believe advertising is probably coming down, right? So at a time when they probably have, at a minimum, you would call it uncertainty into their forecast and pipeline, they went out and made a strategic acquisition while nobody was paying attention to potentially redesign the category of newspapers around, I don't know what the category would be called, but let's just say audio newspapers or podcast newspapers or something along those lines. And so here's a company being thoughtfully aggressive. And so I hope that while we're going to be freaked out and we have to do some very hard things, that we can also have a mindset that is forward leaning.
I agree. How do people get in touch with you, Christopher?
Lockhead.com.
How do people yeah. not get in touch with you?
Don't touch me. Although normally I would love to give you a hug, but Lockhead.com and everything else hangs off of that. Lockhead.com.
Fantastic.
Hey, which was built by my friend Jaime Jay, and I think it's absolutely fantastic.
Fantastic site, man. Hey. One bonus kind of thing I just wanted to add out. We're talking about this, but because being a an old cop intel guy, whatever else, being in these different places, this is the one. I think the other thing people got to be careful for, though, and you've got to watch. Christopher and I talked about this on his podcast, but as we're now in quarantine, as we self isolate, you're going to see certain types of crime drop, and you can't lull yourself into thinking is that hey, it's changed, things are changed. You folks, you got to lock your doors, lock your windows, lock your cars, keep your garages shut, because like everything else, there will be a time. My concern from a public safety standpoint is that while we will have a lull here, people, I don't care. Again, there are people in this society who they are wolves. They prey on sheep. That's why you have sheepdogs out there to stand between the wolves and the sheep. Don't let your guard down as you're focused on all this other stuff. Keep an eye out for your personal safety, your personal protection. Just elevate your game a little bit and realize that even during this lull, there will still be those people out there. And when things start coming back, guess what? We'll follow them. So will the people who want to take advantage of the weak in business and the weaker in our society and the people who are struggling to get by. They will become victims. So to Chris's point, just be thoughtfully aggressive and radically generous. Take it under, start looking out for your fellow man, not only online, but offline and out in the real world. So we didn't touch upon that. I just kind of wanted to throw that out there because I think that's one aspect of this. People are so consumed with this. We've still got to remember there are still elements in society that are waiting for situations like this to prey upon the weak and the vulnerable. And we all have to keep an eye out for that.
I call those people assholes.
I call them, suspects, step to the mic, sir.
Well, thank you, Morgan. Thank you, Christopher. This has been an amazing hour. I really appreciate your flexibility. And thank you so much for your insight. And you guys mean the world to me. You guys are incredible and super intelligent. And I just really appreciate you for sharing your insight with everyone here. And I'm just blessed to know you guys. And as we go through this challenge, I think it's times like this that, without getting again too woo-woo, it's times like this that we can really use to leverage continuing on and doing good stuff. I tomorrow's going to come. Next month is going to come. What are you going to do in that time to get there?
Is this where we sing Annie and Tomorrow from the movie Annie?
Tomorrow. No, I think Christopher should put back on his Rolling Stones. That was
good. Yeah, no, I think this is where we fire up Sympathy for the Devil.
Well, actually, speaking of that, as long as Keith Richards is still alive, we all have hope.
Because if Keith goes, then the apocalypse started.
That's when you worry. Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Well, yes. Thank you so much again. For everybody out there, if you want to learn more about Morgan, go to morganwright.us. And everything that you need to know about Christopher, you can find at lockhead.com. That's LOCHHEAD. And go check out Morgan and Christopher on his relatively late, one of his last-ish episodes on Follow Your Different. You can also learn a lot about Christopher's thoughts on LinkedIn marketing. And, of course, everything keeping up to speed with what Morgan has going on at morganwright.us. And thanks again for tuning in. Thank you, Morgan. Thank you, Christopher.
Thank you, Jaime Jay.
All right, everybody, take it easy.
Love you, Jaime.